United we stand, divided we fall. Unity is strength. The origin of this way of thinking is unknown. Some people think that it was given to us from the Greek, while others believe that it comes from the Bible. However, we all know this concept. The School of Science and Technology, or SST, is the perfect example of this mindset. There are over 400 students and staff that spend 8 hours a day together, but every single one of them with their own opinion on what's happening in the world. Aside from being an academic titan, SST has a rich and diverse population, different cultures, different languages, and despite their differences, they unite to make the impossible happen. In December of 2015, an email was sent to the Social Studies Department inviting the school to take a nationwide field trip to the presidential inauguration in Washington, D.C.
First of all, I was just like, wow, it's amazing that the school's doing this because, you know, I come from a family of teachers and, you know, but it's from the Valley and Wesco is a pretty low economic area and none of them were ever able to do trips like on that level. So, you know, when that was the first thing I heard pretty much on like, I think it was like my second or third day of work, I was like, wow, like that's really impressive that, you know, it seems so normal to them. Like, oh, it's just as a matter of fact, we're going on this trip. So, you know, would you like to help out and come? So it was impressive and it was kind of a warm welcome, you know, to that school to know that that was the kind of environment that I'd be working in.
Immediately, the teachers took this opportunity and started gathering students to potentially represent the School of Science and Technology across the nation. Fundraising became a priority for the students and a goal was set in place.
We had the kids come during the summer, twice a week, if not more. They came twice a week to make crafts and then on the weekends they would sell them at the farmers market. And we had a rummage sale. We wrote letters to local businesses and people that we knew, churches, things like that. We had just every means of fundraising that we could think of, we tried it.
Like the last day of school was a Thursday and we, Miss Martinez and Miss L and I and Miss Sharon, we were all in Miss Sharon's room and we were planning, okay, what days can we meet over the summer during the week? What crafts can we have the kids make? We'll teach them how to do it. We'll have them make it. Where can we set up for farmers markets and fundraising booths? At which locations? And we got a schedule together, got it out. Kids just started signing up and showing up, and so some kids would come during the week and on the weekends every week of the summer.
On January 19, 2017, news reporters, students, and teachers were gathered in the cafeteria preparing to head to the airport. At this moment, SST was in anyone's radar willing to write about the small school in San Antonio, Texas that was about to witness history in person.
Mientras tanto, estudiantes de secundaria y preparatoria están viajando hoy a Washington D.C. para estar presentes, para asistir a la toma de poder de Donald Trump. Por lo menos 25 alumnos serán testigos de esta ceremonia histórica.
No importa la decisión que haya pasado, quién haya ganado, lo bonito es que nos va a tocar de experimentar de esta transición del poder, de que de un gobierno de democracia a otro republicano. Lo importante es que nosotros vamos a disfrutar y vamos a tener una linda experiencia allá y disfrutarnos del día.
Something you may have noticed is the odd-looking scarves we're all wearing. The concept of this outstanding clothing accessory came from the fact that we needed a way not to get lost from our group. An earlier concept of this idea was to have the scarf be our uniform color. Clearly, that was going to be a problem since we were going to a very patriotic event and everyone was going to be wearing red, white, and/or blue. Instead, it was decided by the Nerd Committee that we should cosplay as students from the fictional school of Hogwarts from the Harry Potter universe. People in DC loved to point this out, and some hated us for it, but I'm getting ahead of myself. A teacher's worst nightmare in a scenario like this is to lose a precious child or to have an issue that won't allow the gift from the storks go with the rest of the group. With this particular field trip, the stakes were even higher.
I will feel better when we're on the other side of security, all
yes.
Together as a group.
I told my mom the last thing I'm worried about is getting through security because everything else is out of our hands.
Even if I'm just traveling by myself, I'm nervous about TSA, even though I've never had an issue. And so knowing that for a few of our kids, this was the first time traveling, I was worried that it was going to be an unfamiliar process, that something would happen and, you know, they wouldn't have the right size of liquids or shampoos or they'd have to throw something away. And 33 people is a lot to get through security, and it was the inauguration week, and we were worried that security was going to be upped and they were going to be even more strict.
All was set and everyone started loading onto the magic school bus that would lead us to the gateway of planes. We arrived at the San Antonio International Airport and smoothly paced past TSA and arrived at our terminal.
But it turned out to be a breeze. Everybody got through relatively easily. I think for a lot of people it was exciting because they didn't really know what to expect. And that was nice when it was over and done with. Once we were through security the first time and at the airport in San Antonio, it was nice to be able to just know that all we had to do was wait.
It was at this moment where people's true colors started showing. Some went off with their chaperone to Starbucks, while others went to get fried chicken at Cane's. This was truly the end of times that began to split the SST class. Suddenly, the unexpected happened.
What happened with Martinez?
They switched our gate.
And so we have to walk all the way across to the other side of the airport.
Mm-hmm. We went from A3 and they moved us all the way to A2. I don't know if we can handle that.
I thought Washington was far.
How were we going to get to Washington if we kept getting mixed up with terminals and luggage? We were screwed, doomed. Nothing could make this. Ooh, a puppy.
And he comes out here to calm travelers.
Oh, nice.
This is a dog that walks from wing to wing of the airport building to serve as a therapy dog to those who are stressed at the airport. For me, this worked. For some other students, well, they had other alternatives. The main one used on this trip was Charade. Charade was originally a kind of riddle, probably invented in France during the 18th century, and it's a game in which a word or a phrase is given to a person and the rest of the group must try and figure out what word or phrase is being acted out by the main person. In this case, it was an app that gave you a prompt that ranged from movies to songs to celebrities, and it was a great time passer, a time waster. It was great for passing time. Finally, it was time not to go to the inauguration, no, something far more magical, boarding and flying on the plane. However, this is when we started to have real hiccups, and I mean, not my dramatic examples of it, but real hiccups.
So what happened?
He lost his ID.
Where did he leave it?
Under the chair, right?
No. And who gave it back to him?
The lady at the front desk.
But as a group, that wasn't the worst thing that could have happened. This was the worst thing that could have happened.
Right hand side, please. We're going to have to start checking them. That's going to have to be checked. Step on over here. That's going to fit underneath the seat. That's going to fit underneath the seat. If you have a roller coaster.
This could have been bad for a number of reasons, but there's a very specific one. This wasn't a direct flight. We were going from the San Antonio International Airport to the Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport, and then from there we were going to take another plane to the Baltimore-Washington International Airport. What if the carry-ons that were checked in got stuck in Atlanta? Or worse, what if they went on another plane in a completely different destination? Sure, you might say that I'm paranoid because the odds of losing luggage is 0.39%, and I shouldn't even be worried because the trip already happened and I know no one loses anything, but still. Have to make this dramatic somehow. Anyway, back to our main story. We were all boarding the plane and we were greeted with the usual customary if something were to happen, blah blah blah. And then finally, takeoff. The bird was in the air. A rather large bird that carried 100 plus smaller birds from point A to point B. Yours truly was used to being in the air thanks to being my alter ego as Iron Man. But for others, this was their first time on a plane.
I really wanted to cry on takeoff because it was like a hammer hitting your skull, like, for the first time. Like, that's a pretty accurate description. And so it was just, like, a really terrifying experience.
The airplane was taking a long time to take off, and then so I told Jose, I asked him, how fast do you think it has to go to take off? And then Jose, I don't know, like, not that fast. I mean, the engines are pretty big, like, it could just take off. And then, after one little turn, it was like Star Wars. I mean, we just, like, blast off, and then we're all scared.
Atlanta, home of the capital of the U.S. state of Georgia. The city played an important part in both the Civil War and the 1960s Civil Rights Movement, and it is also a common place for movie studios to record their movies. I hear it's a beautiful city. However, we stayed at the airport and enjoyed our two-hour layover there.
It was good. It was a little bumpy.
Thoughts on the turbulence?
No, it was all shaking and my ears were all popping.
Outstanding moments from the flight?
Like the part where we almost died?
Yeah, yeah, and then, you know, we saw a flying hippopotamus as well out the window. Everybody missed it.
Those 2 hours flew by, and we were soon boarding our second and last flight of the day. We had reached maximum altitude. With all the time change, the majority of us hadn't realized that it was almost nighttime. The sun hadn't set just yet, but it was getting closer to the horizon. And so, mid-flight, some of us witnessed the sunset. It was a supernatural spectacle. As a young child, we see the world in two dimensions, so the sun just sets behind another piece of land in our eyes. But from the sky, you realize how three-dimensional our world is. As the sun started setting behind the clouds and darkness consumed the east, the lights beneath us began to light up. Small, individual lights. Street lights, park lights, car lights. All of them coming together to light a city or a small town. It didn't matter if it was a fluorescent light or a yellow light or red or neon. They all came together to provide light during a time of darkness. Is this a metaphor or am I being literal? You will never know. We landed, not in Washington, D.C., but instead right outside of it, in Baltimore, the city famous for the hit musical Hairspray, starring my non-favorite basketball player, Zac Efron, and your non-favorite, I didn't know he was still alive, John Travolta, playing a woman. That has nothing to do with this film, but I really liked it. We admired the glorious and modern architecture of the Baltimore International Airport as we walked its halls, much like the introduction of the Monsters in Monsters, Inc. It was finally the moment of truth. Had our luggage and checked-in bags made it all the way to Baltimore? Well, yeah, all of our luggage made it. How boring! It was also during this time that we met our tour guide for the next 30-plus hours that we were going to be in D.C.
I'm Dan Milhoff, your trusty tour director.
You're gonna have to put up with us for a couple of days.
I'm well aware of that. I'm used to it. I'm used to it. Let me go get my bags, and then we can go start this whirlwind excursion.
All right.
Good dinner.
I remember texting my mom, it's a dream come true, because it seemed like something so far off for so long that it was just crazy that we finally actually made it. Like, I looked at all the kids and just, it was incredible. that was exactly what I was thinking. Just, wow, this is a dream. It has to be.
It was nice to be a couple of the first people off of the plane so that we could kind of see all of the students like come out of the gate doors in their scarves, and you know, it was a relief, and it was really exciting to see that we had made it.
Politics are a super touchy subject. In fact, it's so touchy that I've tried to avoid it this far into the movie. However, politics have turned into this thing that everyone keeps talking about. I think this is for the better. It's important to know what's going on in the country that you live in, but at the same time, it's very divisive. It's become so aggressive and hostile just because opinions are different, like two children arguing over a toy or food. Ah, food. A topic we can hopefully all agree on.
What did you go do?
I went to eat.
Yeah?
But now I'm done.
No, you're done. No, you,
what
did
are you eating?
Lots of different things. Mostly starch.
I had dinner in Georgia.
How's your food?
It's okay.
What did you get?
A salad.
Healthy, as it should be. What did you eat?
Lasagna.
A Philly cheesesteak.
It's orange chicken.
Popeye's chicken. I had Lotus Express.
I had the same thing my friend Michael here is eating.
Okay.
I ate at that Chinese restaurant over there. I had lemon chicken.
I ate a web sandwich and then...
He ate fries.
You just ate fries?
Just
out of where?
Fries. From Burger King.
Lotus Express.
Oh, Lotus Express. What did you eat?
I don't remember.
I had some watery chicken. Some kind of spicy chicken.
So this is the watery chicken.
Well, yeah. There was more watery, but I didn't get it.
I ate the same thing. I ate Lotus Express. Same thing as them.
Fries.
What did you eat?
The same thing they had.
We're eating the Great Steak and Potato Company.
Are you enjoying the Great Steak and Potato Company?
Mm. It is supremely overpriced, but it is delicious.
I'm eating the same thing, actually. And just like he said, it's really good, but it's overpriced.
Back at SST, this single fry could put you back 10 cents. Here in Washington, D.C., this fry puts you back 20 cents. Capitalism in the making.
Thank you. What are you eating? caught you at a bad time.
This Cajun chicken right here, you know, we got that fried rice. Something like that. I don't know what it is.
Healthy.
After eating, we hopped back into the Magic Tour bus and traveled 30 minutes north to Washington, D.C. We were able to see from afar the Capitol, the Washington Monument, and the Pentagon. The last stop before arriving at our hotel was the U.S. Marine Corps War Memorial, in honor and in memory of the men of the United States Marine Corps who have given their lives to their country since November 10, 1775. This is the date of the birth of the U.S. Marine Corps. Being there and inhaling the cool D.C. weather filled me with a sense of patriotism, such a beautiful monument that glowed that night. We all viewed the monument in awe before getting back into the bus and heading to the hotel where we would spend the night. Luckily, with a swift transition, we can slip onto the following day, Friday, the day of the inauguration.
Day two!
Day two, day two. Where's everyone else? Where's...
Every significant road that led to anywhere of importance in D.C. had been closed due to the inauguration.
A large part of downtown D.C. is completely shut down, of course, for safety reasons.
Right now, we are on 3rd Street near Independence Avenue, right in front of the U.S. Capitol building where the inauguration will take place. I can tell you road closures throughout the district. And take a look here. 10 pages of those closures, restricted areas, and many of these closures will stay in place over the next 3 days.
Therefore, our Magic Tour bus wasn't the mode of transportation that was going to get us there.
This is a metro map. We're getting on here at Greenbelt Metro Station. We're going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 stops, actually, it is, to Lafont Plaza.
And then from there, we're going to walk out onto the National Mall to the closest security checkpoint. We'll just flow with the crowd. It's essential that everybody stay together. Whoever's near the front of the group, if you see people and they're starting to lag behind a little bit, let me know. It is essential. That is essential. I can't see what's going on behind me. I'm trying to look in front so we can get you guys in to see this historic event.
Finally, we arrived and were lifted into the bright, overcast light. We were greeted by people handing out programs, cops that like cameras, and merchandise being sold every couple of feet. Everything from t-shirts to motivational CDs to flags. Everyone was selling everything. But this began our long walk to get to the line to enter the National Mall. Let me explain how far we were. This is where we started. This is where we needed to go. It might seem like it's not that far, but this took us about 3 hours. No exaggeration. Maybe it's because there were a lot of people, or the fact that we'd get separated from each other and we'd have to wait for them or us to catch up. The point is, we walked and saw a lot of people, seas of people, lots of happy people. Happiness was the exact opposite of what we saw during the election process. Hate and anger filled the words of the majority having a political conversation with someone with the opposing point of view. However, this fire needed to be lit by someone. In this case, the two opposing fires were started from the two leaders of their respective parties. It didn't help that the nation was already tense from circumstances leading to this time. But instead of acting like a united nation and having a conversation, we decided that it was logical to face separate corners and yell into it. That's the problem. This isn't a sporting event where we can root for our favorite team. To quote one of my favorite movies, we're all in this together. Every citizen of the United States should be on the same team. Our different opinions only make us a more powerful team, as long as we communicate and talk to one another. Our goal should be to win together. America was never intended to split to two. It was intended to be different and diverse with the people and the ideas within. When you really think about it, the United States is a young country, and these faces that we're going through kind of show our age. But to the pleasure of you, the viewer, I'll stop my sermon short. The plot of the story demands it. During our marathon, we saw different landmarks that we've seen before at night, but now during the day. We arrived at the fenced Washington Memorial, where the line began to enter the National Mall. By this time, the inaugural event had already begun. Suddenly, we found a fellow Texan that works at a news site that interviewed the SST class. Abby Livingston, the reporter for the Texas Tribune, was attracted to our eye-catching scarves. She interviewed several of the students and our chaperones. The article is currently available on the interwebs if you want to read all of our thoughts. We finally reached the entrance of the National Mall after what felt like the 2016 presidential election, but we were separated by a fence. Luckily, some of the Secret Service agents saw our beautiful scarves and allowed us to join the rest of the group. However, others in line weren't too happy with that.
I can't. They're only letting Gryffindor in. Training like 2 or 3 hours ago.
But then I have to carry it.
It stopped, Mom.
As we stepped onto the white tiles that covered the lawn, Vice President Michael Pence took the stage.
Vice President-elect, would you raise your right hand and repeat after me? I, Michael Richard Pence, do solemnly swear.
I, Michael Richard Pence, do solemnly swear.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
And That I will well and faithfully discharge.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office on which I'm about to enter.
The duties of the office on which I am about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations. God bless you. God bless you.
Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, Donald John Trump, do solemnly swear.
I, Donald John Trump, do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully execute.
That I will faithfully execute.
The office of President of the United States.
The office of President of the United States.
And will, to the best of my ability.
And will, to the best of my ability.
Preserve, protect, and defend.
Preserve, protect, and defend
the Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Mr. President. Yeah!
What a great honor to be able to introduce for the first time ever anywhere the 45th President of the United States of America, Donald J. Trump.
Did I get that one right?
We, the citizens of America, are now joined in a great national effort to rebuild our country and restore its promise for all of our people. Together, we will determine the course of America and the world for many, many years to come. We will face challenges. We will confront hardships. But we will get the job done. We are one nation, and their pain is our pain. Their dreams are our dreams, and their success will be our success. We share one heart, one home, and one glorious destiny. At the bedrock of our politics will be a total allegiance to the United States of America. And through our loyalty to our country, we will rediscover our loyalty to each other. When you open your heart to patriotism, there is no room for prejudice. The Bible tells us how good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. We must speak our minds openly, debate our disagreements honestly, but always pursue solidarity. When America is united, America is totally unstoppable. Together, we will make America strong again. We will make America wealthy again. We will make America proud again. We will make America safe again. And yes, together, we will make America great again. Thank you, God bless you, and God bless America. Thank you.
It was amazing to be there. It was, I felt out of body. I didn't know what to expect. And I was standing there watching him on the Jumbotron and looking forward into the distance where he was really standing this big. And I was like, I'm here. And I just ended up taking in the moment. But part of me, I'll admit, started wondering how different could this day have been, you know? There's a lot of mixed feelings about our current president, now current president. So, of course, all of those other thoughts wandered through. But ultimately, I was just very happy to be with a group of kids, with a school I love, there, just taking it in together.
I was happy we were finally in, and I'm happy that we made it on time. And I remember I wanted to take a lot of pictures because the kids walked in, and they were going crazy. It was pretty open in the area that we came into, so we kind of spread out a little bit, and it was nice knowing that there weren't a lot of people around in that point, at that point in time at least, to where we had to keep the kids reined in. And so it was kind of nice to see them really excited on their phones, taking pictures, really enjoying that moment. And then when Mike Pence got sworn in, I was paying attention, and then when the transfer of power between Obama and Trump, I honestly didn't expect myself to be as emotional as I was. It was interesting to see and interesting to feel that shift.
I was taking it all in. I didn't have a thought for that whole thing except just, wow, I guess. Just I was just absorbing everything. Yeah, and keeping up with the kids. I was counting heads the whole time, but looking for dangerous people. But mostly just wow, and listening, taking it in, taking pictures, just being in the moment.
It was still a little emotional for me. I really, enjoyed seeing it. I kind of thought just watching it on the Jumbotron might take away from some of the experience because we weren't actually up close, but of course that wasn't very realistic. There was a lot of people there, so our chances of getting up close, was not to be. But it was still really nice. We could still see the Capitol. We could still see, the flags and the adornments on the Capitol building from afar. So, we still had the feeling, we were there among, supporters, non-supporters. But even still, it was very peaceful.
It was bittersweet, personally, I didn't vote, for Mr. Trump. I was a Bernie Sanders supporter from the get-go. And when he dropped out, I was gonna vote for Hillary Clinton just because I didn't want Trump to win. But obviously that didn't happen. So that was kind of disappointing. But at the same time, it's just amazing to be able to be in D.C. I'd never been to D.C. I'd never been really part of such a big event. I don't think really probably any of us have, because no matter what show or anything I think I'd have been to, there's never been anything like that on that level. I mean, I'm not even sure of the total number, but there's never been a part of something that big, and then let alone a part of history, to see, a moment in our history's progress. Whether it goes the way I want it or not, it's important to be there for that. And it's important, to be there with the kids for that and answer questions on what they were thinking. And, it was a really good moment to be there and witness history, But on the other hand, it was just disappointing from who was going to be taking on the next step of history. But I guess life is like that sometimes.
We walked out of the National Mall in a surreal state. It wasn't every day that you were among the people that witnessed history in person. We followed the herd of people that were exiting the event, but to do so, we had to pass by the media area. This was filled with everyone from CNN, NBC, ABC, Univision, all of them. There was a news anchor that was asking if anyone wanted to be interviewed for ABC One, the online streaming service of the network, with their post-inaugural thoughts. Something that should be noted of SST is that we'll never shy away from being public, and so we were interviewed.
Guys, how should we? I feel like we need like something to end it on. What should we do? What should we say?
SST! SST!
But then on the flip side, something worse than that, someone who is completely unqualified started interviewing the interviewer. That person was
your
me.
Name is?
Now, as I asked, you want to talk to the camera or are you?
Just talk to them.
You tell me what to do. All right.
I'm not that important. They're
yeah,
the important
you're the most
ones.
Important person.
My wish.
It's true. My name's Maggie Ruley. I'm a reporter for ABC News. I do TV, radio, and digital for ABC. So what we just did was for digital. We have live stream coverage from pretty much everywhere in D.C. today. And anchored coverage back in New York, covering what's happening on the mall, off the mall, later tonight at the balls, anything you want to know.
Perfect. So we've been prepping for this for about a year and a half. How long have you guys been prepping?
Forever.
Forever?
I think the prep never stops.
How long have you been here? Did you get, are you from out of town or are you from D.C.?
So I'm based out of D.C.,
okay.
But I started with ABC News about 7 months ago.
Oh, okay.
So my prep with ABC News started the day I started, pretty much. I started just about around conventions, and we've been all politics all the time ever since.
Now, quickly, before we have to leave, because we have to run out, the weirdest thing you've seen.
Today?
Or the weirdest thing you've covered. Throughout any of this.
I would say constantly updating scripts with the latest tweets from presidential candidates as well as top politicians and cabinet members. And, you know, sometimes it's amazing what people say publicly.
So in the tweets, they're timed like 30 minutes before the broadcast. So because they're trying to make the news. So like Donald Trump always tweets at like 6 o'clock.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So now you know. That's a peek behind the curtain.
We're always like waiting for it. Like, what's it going to be? And then we're scrambling.
Perfect.
It is always entertaining to watch the scramble right before a news.
Yeah, it's fun.
All right, thank you so much.
We want to thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you guys.
Welcome glad to you guys can
thank
make
you.
It. Thank you so much. You guys are awesome. Thanks.
And with those goodbyes, we were off to the National Air and Space Museum to grab something to eat. It was during this time when something really happened. At about 1:03, a riot started and was quickly contained within a block.
Well, guys, the police are rushing this group of protesters right here. A flashbang just went off. Bricks and rocks being thrown right here at the police. They have just rushed down 12th Street trying to knock some of these protesters down that way. They've just fired flashbang rounds. They are moving toward these protesters right here, many of whom have been throwing rocks and bricks. We just saw it.
This was all happening at the same time we were heading into the National Air and Space Museum, which was quite a long way from this place of riots. However, this isn't the end of our trip. I just faded to black to be more dramatic. Our Friday night consisted of time for ourselves. This would take place on a small boat that traveled within a small lake. The night consisted of a memory that some teachers held as their favorite from the trip.
Oh, the cruise. Seeing you do karaoke, that was... I didn't know you had it in you.
Too bad no one recorded that, because I'm the one who recorded it.
I actually got a little snippet. I did get a little snippet.
Probably you singing Taylor Swift. It was Taylor Swift, right? Yes, of course it was. That was fun, and seeing we sat next to most of the 10th graders, I think they were mostly 10th grade, maybe one or two 9th graders, and just hearing them laugh and getting up constantly and going and dancing, I was worried for a second that, you know, the cruise wasn't going to go off as well, because, you know, some people are awkward and they don't want to go up and dance and be uncool, and I was worried that was going to happen, but it was nice to see everybody enjoy themselves.
Watching the kids dance and all the kids dance and have fun with all the other kids from the other tours, from the other schools.
Keyshawn and Jose were standing on the edge and kind of watching everybody else dance. And I was telling them, like, hey, jump in there, you know, go dance with your friends or, you know, mingle a little bit. And they were like, no. And I was like, all right, if you do it, I'll do it. And so they jumped into the line with a few of the other teachers and the students and chaperones, and I jumped in with them, and it was just a good time had by all.
The night ended with the tired dancers who went to bed, but with another quick swipe, they'll be taking their luggage into the bus. Saturday morning, little did we know that Washington wasn't done surprising us. We went to the Spy Museum in DC. That didn't allow video, so here are a couple of shots of me trying to be sneaky and spy-like. Get it? It's ironic. From there, we went to the National Museum of Natural History. And, well, things got girly.
The morning of the Women's March, it was really important that I feel the students got to see appropriate ways of protesting, especially after we were trying to watch out for like the riots yesterday, make sure we weren't crossing paths with them. But everyone with smiles, everybody was like, oh, there's the Hogwarts school, and even if we had very different views on things, I feel like we all took the time to smile and wave and acknowledge each other as humans. And a lot of them crowded, but it worked. It was great.
You know, the Women's March kind of got started around Donald Trump's treatment and comments surrounding women and even other marginalized groups. And this was a way of participating in government. You know, you don't just vote. That's the easiest way for a lot of people to get involved, but protesting and writing to your senator and your representative are other very valid ways.
I thought that was amazing. That was honestly one of the unexpected parts. You know, I knew that the Women's March was going to be going around or going on. I just didn't realize that we would be getting so close to it. And that was probably one of my favorite parts of the trip, you know, to see the sheer number of people that were coming out, you know, to speak out for women's rights and to speak out for a variety of things. It wasn't just women's rights.
I thought it was really good for the kids to see the kinds of things that people were saying. There were a few posters that I have eighth graders with me, and I'll be honest, I tried very hard to steer them away from. But in general, I think it was really cool to see. It was definitely another piece of history that we got to be a part of.
And well, that's where this story ends.
If you get the opportunity, definitely go. It was incredible.
I just have to say, I think all of our students and our chaperones and our teachers did an amazing job. We didn't lose a kid once, thankfully. We managed to stay together, which for those who weren't there, don't really understand how difficult it was at times going through crowds of people and, you know, barricades and having to turn around and regroup and make sure that we had everybody. There was never a panic moment. We all stayed together. All the students worked really well. They were looking out for one another.
I think really the thing I hope is going forward that these students learn that participation is an important part of being a citizen, and not just participation when every 4 years for the president, but participating in local elections, you know, state elections, because if you want to make change, if you want to see that be affected, you really need to do it, you know, every year, calling your congressman, you know, doing those kinds of things, not just getting up in arms when every 4 years. So, and I think, you know, this experience is going to be something that gives them that initiative more than just reading it from books. So
I can't believe that this started with a single email a year and a half ago that nobody thought would happen, even some of the other. I can't believe it actually happened. And it's over now. That's crazy.
This bit right here, the one that I'm reading out loud, was the hardest part to write. How do you end a story that is just starting? A bit deep of a question, but isn't that what life is about? this is just another chapter for the history books of our beautiful country. It's up to us how we want it to turn out. I mentioned before how split our country is. I don't want that. It shouldn't be that. Which leads me to the title of this documentary, United. That's what this country used to be. It's what it can be. It is what it must be. Again, I am not a politician, so I'm not here to persuade you to either side. After this last election, I realized we should all have one goal. We should want to save our country. And with your help, we can. This won't happen with yelling or riots, but with conversation, with open minds. With your help, we will restore our nation to be the shining beacon we know it to be. The how we're going to get there isn't a mystery. We will overcome our challenges with the help from our friends, our family, our loved ones, those we trust, and those we will need to trust again in order to prevail. Because the only way we're going to return our home to greatness is to do so together, united.
At the SST School of Science Tech, all the teachers are the best. And the students all are studious, and their parents are impressed. All the admin always smile and say, howdy and how do you do? All we care about you and your future too, and you can make a good grade if you really want to. At the SST School of Science and Technology. Curriculum strong, you can take AP, and of course tuition's free. Come be a part of our family and sing SST, SST. It's the place we wanna be. SST, SST. It's the place we wanna be. Better education, better future for me. That's what I'll get from SST.